James's Church, Piccadilly. This is our third annual iftar during Ramadan, organised with our friends at the City Circle, and we'll be hearing from them in just a moment. In our church here, we're honoured to have Muslim friends and Jewish friends with us here tonight. You dignify us by your presence. You're welcome to this church, which has welcomed people since it was built in 1684. It's an Anglican church, part of the Church of England, and our parish are the streets that surround this church building here in central London. It's a church built as one big room, and that's not necessarily usual for Christian churches, but it was built as one big room by a particular architect, Christopher Wren, in 1684. Why did he build it like that? So that we can see each other and we can hear each other. Our windows, if you look, are clear glass. They're not stained glass, as you find in lots of other churches. That means we can see the world and the world can see us. As one writer has put it, how can you improve on what God has made when God made light? So the sunlight comes through the windows, and the practice of our religion is intimately connected with the world as it is, and that's really important to us. For us gathered here tonight as Abrahamic faiths, there is so much that binds us together, so much that we have in common, and we're celebrating that tonight. And one of the things we have in common is the tradition of fasting. For Jews, Muslims, and Christians, fasting is a way of focusing our minds, reminding us of the gifts we receive in life, and encouraging us to pray. And that's why we, at our church, are so delighted to welcome you here today. Thank you for letting us share in your tradition of iftar. Breaking bread together is an important way of getting to know each other. Talking and eating together is a way of making peace that we value and honour. And so tonight, a bit later, we'll hear from our different faith traditions on a particular topic, one of the defining issues of our time, welcoming the stranger, the refugee crisis, and what our own response to this is as people of faith. We have an amazing panel lined up for you here. Give them a round of applause. They're going to be hearing from them later on. And we're honoured to welcome Shaykh Haytham Tamim to speak to us later too. So we hope you have a really good evening. Please know that you're very welcome here. We're so glad that you've travelled to be with us here tonight.
Thank you for that very warm welcome, Lucy, and thank you everybody else. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Ben Devlander. I'm one of the two co-chairs of City Circle. And on behalf of the charity, it gives me great pleasure to welcome you to what, as Lucy said, is now our third Interfaith Iftar, here in partnership with our friends at St. James's Piccadilly. Ramadan Kareem, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. It's always such a pleasure to be back here at St. James's Church. And indeed, it's such an honour to be able to share and celebrate what is, after all, part of the Muslim faith, as guests in a place of somebody else's. We don't take for granted that this type of interfaith and cross-community event couldn't take place in many parts of the world, including in many Muslim-majority countries. It's a testimony to the open-mindedness of all of you here tonight, and indeed the church in which we're guests, for not just tolerating, but for openly welcoming and coming here to share and learn from each other. It's the early Islamic leader, Ali ibn Abi Talib, Imam Ali alayhi salam, who reminded his followers that there are two types of people in this world, your brothers in faith and your equals in humanity. It's this spirit in which we gather here tonight. For those of you not familiar with City Circle, we're a charity that was set up 19 years ago by a new generation of British Muslims who wanted to give something back to their communities, but also to fill a gap that wasn't being met by even mainstream media or mosques and places of worship. Established as an open circle for open minds, the main project that's defined the last 19 years has been our programme of regular talks, which cover a mix of social, economic, professional, religious, political topics, and which allowed people a safe space to explore ideas and also to be a window on, be a window for the wider community to find out about Islam. In addition to that, we've since branched out and run a few volunteering projects, chief among which are our programme of Saturday schools. These are two schools run entirely by volunteers on Saturday mornings, supplementary schools for school-age students who need extra help, extra tuition with their English and maths. Many of them come from disadvantaged backgrounds, operating in deprived parts of London, including in the area of Grenfell Tower. As with all our projects, they're run entirely by volunteers. We don't have any full-time staff, we don't get any government grants. So our greatest resource has always been the human capital of our volunteers and their desire to give back to society and to support others as better than themselves. I saw earlier this week an announcement from the Charity Commission announcing that Muslims are expected to donate up to £100 million in this country this month during Ramadan. That equates to £38 per second during the course of the month. So, with all this volunteering, with all this financial generosity, what's the purpose of fasting during Ramadan? Well, it gives us a chance, as Lucy said, to focus on our spiritual purpose in this world, away from the material concerns that occupy our minds so much of the time. It's also a deeply humbling endeavour, and one which is one of the few things in this life that we can't buy our way out of. It reminds us that whether you're rich or poor, whether you're old or young, no matter which part of the world you or your family may come from, or which beliefs you may hold, or which spiritual journey you may be on, deep down we all have the same basic needs and desires, not just for food and drink, but for things like respect, acceptance, and tolerance. And by being here tonight, every one of you has made such a powerful statement about our roles as a country, as a community, and as individuals. And for that, we'd like to thank you.
Our topic for discussion tonight is called Welcoming the Stranger. It's been called one of the defining issues of our time, the forced movement of people, also known as the refugee crisis. Recently, in this church at St James's, we were honoured to welcome Lord Alf Dubs, who came to the UK on the kinder transport from Nazi Germany in the 1930s. He is, from his own experience, working hard in the House of Lords to affect public policy and raise the issue of refugees. Tonight, from our panel, we'll hear what different faith groups are doing and encourage one another to find ways to welcome the stranger. From the Christian tradition, Jesus told a story when he was asked by a lawyer, "Who is my neighbour?" He told this story, that a man was beaten up at the side of the road. Several people walked past, including priests, for reasons we don't discover. Then one person stopped, bound up the man's wounds, put him on his donkey, took him to an innkeeper, and then paid for whatever the man needed. Jesus' question to the crowd was, who was the person who was a neighbour to the man who needed it? The answer came back, the one who showed mercy. What Christians learn from that is that there is no particular group of people defined by religion or ethnic heritage or geography that is our neighbour. The only thing that defines a neighbour is someone in need. That's it. Whoever it is, wherever they're from. We learn this from our Jewish brothers and sisters too, from the scriptures that we share. I'm honoured to have you, and would you please give an opening statement about what you believe from the Islamic perspective about welcoming the stranger.
I mean, praise be to God, the beneficial, the beneficent, the merciful. The first refugee crisis happened in the Muslim world was from Mecca to Medina. At that time, Muslims were expelled from their homes in Mecca, a very beloved city to their hearts, including the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. They were expelled from Mecca and they left to Medina. In Medina, which well known now in Saudi, the Prophet and his companions, they have no homes, nothing, but they have been welcomed by the community in Medina, and which we call the community of Al-Ansar. Those who hosted them and welcomed them, who shared with them their homes, shared with them their money, shared with them their businesses. And this was the very first refugee crisis we ever witnessed as a Muslim community in our history. And we learned from the Prophet, peace be upon him, that the first thing he established in Medina, apart from establishing the mosque, the very first thing he established a concept of mu'afat. Mu'afat, which is brotherhood, sisterhood. So he made a brotherhood between the refugees and the supporters in Medina. So for instance, every house, they have been made brothers or sisters to whom soever is coming from Mecca. So X will be a brother of Y, and Y will be a brother of X, and so on and so forth. So they will host them, they will look after them until they establish themselves, and then they can move on in life.
Speaker is Simon Perfect. Simon is the chair of Westminster Refugees Welcome, a volunteer group working to encourage Westminster Council to resettle Syrian refugee families in our borough. He's a researcher on contemporary religion in Britain, and he teaches at SAIS. Simon, over to you.
Thank you very much, Lucy, and I'm delighted to be here. I'm a member of St James's Church, Piccadilly, and so it's great to see so many people here as well. As Lucy said, I'm one of the co-chairs of Westminster Refugee Welcome, and we are a group of residents and volunteers here trying to encourage the government to resettle some Syrian refugees here in the borough. The background to this is in 2015, when the government made an announcement that it would resettle 20,000 refugees from the Syrian conflict here in Britain. So far about 10,500 have been resettled here, and we want to do the same in Westminster. And I'm pleased to say that Westminster City Council is going ahead with implementing the scheme here in the borough. One part of the scheme is called community sponsorship, and this is where the local community gets involved in resettling refugees in. So the local community will find a property for the refugee family, the sponsoring group will help them to learn English, will help them to integrate into the local community. It's a really big task, but what we're seeing up and down the country is lots of different people from across faiths coming together and making this work for a really amazing goal. At Westminster Refugee Welcome, we want to make this happen here, so what we're looking for is we're looking for landlords who might own private property that they've been willing to let out to refugees. And we're also looking for volunteers who want to get involved with us or who want to offer their skills in some way to help integrate the refugees when they arrive, particularly Arabic speakers, to help with translation. And we'd really encourage people here tonight to go back to their local communities and say, is this something that as a community you can do, you can take on the responsibility to sponsor refugees?
I'm delighted to be here. GEDCOR, for the past 40 years, has been reaching out to communities outside of the Jewish community. We believe that people need to meet each other, need to get to know each other, and then we're not going to seem strange to each other anymore. We're going to seem like friends. And out of that, and out of also, I think, the British Jewish community's understanding of themselves as a community made of migrants, former migrants, and as former refugees, we've started at JCOR the Jump Befriending Scheme. And what that does is for young unaccompanied asylum seekers and refugees who arrive here completely on their own, having left their families behind, having to acclimatise to a totally new environment, without language skills, often quite traumatised, what we do is we find warm trained adults, we train them, we find warm adults and we pair them together with young refugees, and we say to them, you guys are going to be friends, you can go and explore London together, you can practice English with this grown up, you can ask any questions about the new culture. You can learn to trust them, because for a lot of young refugees, trust is one of the hardest things to regain after a journey like the one that people have gone through when they come to this country. So our hope is that over a year, and maybe longer, a really warm, really, really strong relationship will grow up between the young person who's arrived here and our volunteer befrienders. And our befrienders are of all backgrounds, all faiths and none. Although J4 is a Jewish organisation, our befrienders, our volunteers come from every background that you can find in London. And I think that's one of its beauties and its strengths. And at the moment we have about 30 young people. We're hoping to get a little bit bigger. And I have to say it's a very, very good job to be doing, to watch young people find their way in this country and to feel like they have something safe to do.
Thank you very much, Viv. And our last speaker on the panel is Evelyn Namutevi, who is a member of our congregation here at St James's. We're delighted that you're on our panel, Evelyn. You are a refugee from Uganda who's also volunteered at the Red Cross Destitution Centre. Evelyn is a member of our church council, so she's helping to run the place right now and is currently working as an accountant. So, Evelyn, what do you have to say to us?
Thank you so much, Lucy, for the introduction. My name is Evelyn, and I've been here to the church. I came here, I didn't know anyone, but the church welcomed me personally. I came here, I was looking for asylum, and the church welcomed me, and Mom Park introduced me to the whole congregation, and I became as a member of the congregation, and this church is like a family. When you go away and don't come to church, it's like I'm missing my family. So I personally am here by myself, and the church helping through my whole process of looking for a lawyer to help me through my asylum process. And when I was granted asylum, everyone came to my court to support me. And when I was granted asylum, I volunteered here to work in the accounts department because I have a passion in accounts. And I'm doing my SEC right now, and I'm joining university in September to do finance degree. And I'm just so grateful that the church welcomed me as an asylum seeker, and I'm now a refugee.
Simon, I just wanted to ask you, you mentioned community sponsorship. That's a specific scheme that I've outlined it. If anyone here wanted to get involved with community sponsorship, what's the first thing? They're sitting here and they're thinking, I'd like to help resettle a vulnerable Syrian family. What should they do?
So, you're absolutely right. Community sponsorship is a specific scheme that is part of a wider scheme whereby the central government has a certain amount of money and it will allocate that money to local authorities that choose to be part of the scheme. If you are part of a community and you like the idea of this, the first thing you need to think about is, have you got a core team within your community of people who are able to give quite a substantial amount of time to put together a resettlement plan to make this resettlement work? So that's people who've got to have administrative skills, they've got to might need to have some financial skills as well. So you need to first of all check, have you got the institutional capacity to do so? Then there's various other requirements if you want to become a community sponsor. You have to be able to raise a minimum of £9,000, which is a kind of emergency fund, but you'll probably have to raise more than that. And you'd also have to try and find property in the private sector whereby the landlord is willing to let that property out to a refugee family. That could be the hardest part, finding a property, particularly in London, but it has been done in London. It's been done in various buildings. There are those landlords out there. And there may be some landlords among you or watching who might think, actually, this is something that you would like to do. If so, you can either get in contact with us at Westminster Refugee Welcome, and our email is in the pamphlet, or you can get in contact with a group called Migrants Organised, and they do a lot of work with community sponsor groups in London as well. And also a group called Sponsor Refugees, and they're set up by Citizens UK, and they also provide a lot of support with community sponsors as well. So there's lots of groups that you can, if you're interested in this, there's lots of organisations you can contact that have got experience about it.
There are plenty of traditions in the Quran, in the Sunnah, from the Prophet, which encourages the people to do goodness about welcoming the stranger. For instance, we know that Islam has been built on five. So we have the five pillars of Islam. Probably almost all of us learned this through our ear or other things. So one of the pillars of Islam is the pillar of zakah, which is compulsory charity. So this pillar, one share of that pillar, it's divided to eight shares. When you take 2.5% of the wealth, for those who are wealthy, you distribute 2.5%, which is probably definitely less than the tax man. So you take 2.5%, you distribute to one of these eight categories. One of these eight categories, which we mentioned in the Quran clearly, is a stranger, Ibn Sabil, what we call it. Ibn Sabil is the stranger. And in the tradition of the Prophet Muhammad, which we call the Sunnah, he said once to his cousin, Abdullah bin Abbas, he said, be in this world like a stranger or a traveler. And this is so beautiful narration, very short, very beautiful narration. It means be like a stranger. Don't attach yourself to this world. Deal with it, live with it, struggle with it, be happy with it, but don't attach your heart to this world. Attach your heart to the hereafter. So he's advising us through his cousin Abdullah bin Abbas that you shouldn't attach yourself to this world. Rather, attach yourself to the hereafter. From Mecca to Medina, people were refugees. So they've been hosted in Medina. The Prophet himself was a refugee. He was a migrant, and he's been welcomed by the people of Medina, which we call the people of Al-Ansar, the supporters. So for that very reason, in many traditions, the Prophet, peace be upon him, he said, whomsoever is fulfilling the need of his brother, God will fulfill his need. It's a very beautiful, deep tradition. He's saying that if you want God to fulfill your need, and I always give this recipe to my students, to my friends, try this recipe. If you are doing something and it's being blocked, you to your right it's blocked, you go left it's blocked, you go to the center it's blocked, pause it, go and help somebody who is in need. You will definitely find a path and it will be facilitated for you. Try it and let me know. It's been tested. And the tradition is very clear. If you want God to support you, support your brother who is in need.